Good evening, everyone. I'm Tracy Moore, and I'm thrilled to welcome you to our first ever virtual Stand Up for Kids night. I'm back. This important event presented by our ever dedicated Stand Up for Kids lead community partner, CIBC Children's Foundation, gives us the opportunity to celebrate incredible youth who have broken down so many barriers in order to achieve their academic goals. In addition to highlighting their achievements this evening, we're going to be recognizing six Canadians who are working hard to support children and youth in their communities who, through no fault of their own, have experienced abuse, neglect, and abandonment. As you can tell, tonight looks a little different from past Stand Up for Kids nights and recognition night events, a change that was made in order to keep everyone safe during the COVID-19 pandemic. While we would have much preferred to be able to be all together, I want to see you all, there are some positive aspects of this virtual format. So get this, we've got the ability to welcome even more donors, supporters, partners, and students from across the country who may not otherwise have been able to attend. And also being able to make tonight even more accessible in French and with closed captioning. We're so thankful that you made the decision to dial in tonight and join us. Welcome to our donors, supporters, Lynn Factor Stand Up for Kids National Award finalists, Children's Aid Foundation of Canada staff and members of the board and committees, and a huge and warm welcome to the students and the graduates. So proud of you. Thank you all for joining us and for coming together as a community committed to improving outcomes and celebrating accomplishments. Since launching Stand Up for Kids, Children's Aid Foundation of Canada has seen our community of supporters from across the country grow. And we are thrilled to be able to highlight some of our allies tonight and support the innovative work they are doing to support young people involved with child welfare. Now in its third year, the Lynn Factor Stand Up for Kids National Award gives one winner the opportunity to direct a $50,000 grant, and five finalists are given the opportunity to each direct a $5,000 grant to a child welfare, child rights, or child or youth serving organization here in Canada. This award recognizes the dedication of these individuals who share Lynn Factor's lifelong commitment to supporting vulnerable children and youth involved in the child welfare system as they overcome barriers to build brighter futures for themselves. Last year, Erwin Elman, former Ontario Provincial Advocate for Children and Youth, dedicated his $50,000 grant to Feathers of Hope Hair Story and the Ontario Child Advancement Coalition. Last year's winners are helping to create new ways for youth to engage in policy change, programs to support youth leaving care, early intervention initiatives and play therapy, and camp experiences for kids in care. If you're interested in reading more about the incredible impacts made by the organization supported by last year's finalists, check out the foundation's website at cafdn.org/standupforkidsaward. Each year, award nominees are assessed by the Lynn Factor Stand Up for Kids National Committee, a third-party group of leaders who are passionate about child welfare. The committee is chaired by Don Galloyne, past president and CEO of Manulife, former Children's Aid Foundation of Canada board member, and generous personal donor. On behalf of the foundation, I'd like to thank the committee for their time and commitment to this important award selection process. Let's meet this year's finalists and hear a bit more about what they're doing to stand up for kids in their communities. Take a look. Is a member of the Mishkagogamang First Nation and was born into foster care in Vancouver, British Columbia. She first started advocating because she didn't want her foster siblings to go through the same systems she had. Ashley has produced meaningful youth in care-led research, developed impactful programs, and provided policy recommendations to evaluate and help transform child welfare legislation, policies, and programs, including Bill C-92, an act to respect First Nations, Métis, and Inuit children, youth, and families. Through her work, Ashley has made an extraordinary difference in the lives of youth in care.
My fondest memory so far is of the very first National Gathering of First Nations Youth in Care, which happened in October 2019. Getting to meet everyone and see the incredible advocacy they're doing gives me hope, and I know their voices are being heard.
Nicole Bonney has dedicated her professional life to creating sustainable change at the systemic level in child welfare. When Nicole first started working with children and youth in the child welfare system, she observed the overrepresentation of Black children, youth, and families. This led her to want to understand more about anti-Black racism in the system and gave her a passion to support those who are on the margin. In 2019, she was named the first Black CEO in the history of Ontario Association of Children's Aid Societies and in the province's child welfare sector. She has made and continues to make a positive impact on the lives of children, youth, and families in the Ontario child welfare system.
The most profound moment that I have had while working with children and youth in the child welfare system happened very early on and actually motivated me to do the work that I do. There was a documentary that I had supported, and this was to get the youth voice, particularly Black youth voice, in talking about their experience of being in the system. And what we heard them say was they identified things like not having their needs met through hair care or skin care, but they also identified larger systemic issues around being criminalized in group homes, being treated unfairly, not being heard or listened to, and feeling invisible.
Dylan Cohen is a Jewish and Red River Métis organizer, advocate, and former youth in care from Manitoba. Growing up in care, Dylan knew that the system he experienced wasn't fair and that it could be changed. Before aging out, he founded a Manitoba campaign called 25, Not 21, to challenge child welfare policymakers. Soon after, Dylan moved to Vancouver and became the Fostering Change Initiative's campaign organizer. Dylan successfully shifted the Fostering Change Initiative from the project of a large community foundation to a grassroots youth-led political and capacity training campaign to support young people leaving care. Dylan's vision and work is felt across BC and Canada, and he continues to push for change in the child welfare system.
My most profound moment was easily the Policy Solutions Day event that we put on every year, where I brought 50 plus young people to Victoria to meet with decision makers and ultimately address the premier and dozens of cabinet ministers and MLAs and all of these party officials and government officials to speak truth to power and to show young people that their voices can affect systems and that we can get media and the public's attention on it.
Julie Despatie's commitment to supporting permanency for children and youth in families grew from her own adoption journey. Julie always knew that her children would define her purpose and redirect her voice for change. Informing Adopt for Life, Ontario's Association for Kin, Customary Care, and Adoptive Parents and Caregivers, she created a unified voice and invaluable peer network for adoptive parents and permanent caregivers. A changemaker at heart, Julie has helped shape legislation designed to strengthen the child welfare system to better protect some of Ontario's most vulnerable young people. Julie has been a passionate advocate in the nonprofit sector for more than 20 years.
When our son came to us at the age of 8 years old, he was struggling with his schooling and in fact was falling behind on every subject, especially with his reading. I decided to do phonics with him, but Aiden had an emotional resistance to learning, so that resulted in ongoing tantrums, but he persevered and completed it successfully. What this has taught me is that when a child or a youth has a committed adult in their life that stands by them, they are enabled to reach their full potential and go beyond and above our wildest dreams.
Roberta Jameson is a Mohawk from the Six Nations of the Grand River Territory who has achieved many firsts in Canada. She was the first First Nation woman in Canada to earn a law degree, the first woman ombudsman of Ontario, and the first woman elected chief of the Six Nations of the Grand River Territory. As an Indigenous woman, Roberta knew she had a responsibility to work hard to create a better future for the seventh generation. As president and CEO of Inspire, Roberta firmly believes that education, role models, and mentorship are the keys to creating systemic change in Indigenous communities, and has received numerous honorary degrees and awards, including the Order of Canada.
A young First Nations girl told me that the support she received from Inspire was the first time in her life that someone believed in her. She felt validated as an Indigenous person and supported. She was then determined to achieve her potential and her dreams through education.
Dr. Jane Matheson has over 45 years of experience in human service organizations across government, nonprofit, and for-profit organizations. As a former CEO of Woods Homes, a nationally recognized children's mental health center, Jane committed herself to helping children and youth. It was a daily experience of learning something new. Throughout her career, Jane has been steadfast and uncompromising in her quest to improve the lives of children and youth impacted by trauma, disadvantaged by poverty, and marginalized purely by circumstance. She has persistently looked for interventions and treatments that are effective and evidence-based. Jane recognizes that measuring outcomes is crucial to figuring out what works.
Being committed to children really works. It helps people become contributing and strong human beings. And I suppose, unfortunately, one only finds this out after the fact, when young people who are now grown up call you up or take you out for a coffee and say, "Why did you never give up on me?"
Oh, there are truly big things being led by these finalists across the country, and all are so deserving of this recognition. It is so tough to decide, but I won't make you wait. After much deliberation, I'm so excited to announce that the 2020 Lynn Factor Stand Up for Kids National Award winner is Roberta Jameson. Here are a few words from Roberta. Congratulations.
Sago, I'm joining you tonight from the Six Nations of the Grand River Territory, my home. And it is with deep honor and gratitude that I accept the Lynn Factor Stand Up for Kids National Award. You know, I know every child is born with a unique set of gifts. And with support, they can realize their dreams. First Nations, Inuit, and Métis children start, though, with more challenges because of our shared history. And then if children are in care, they have additional challenges. So they require support, role models, mentors, educators who see them as Indigenous children with incredibly rich cultures, languages, and so much to contribute to the country. This is what Inspire does, provide the tools and the support for young children to achieve their potential. So this is what really energizes me. Some of our students have said to me, the financial award is important, but what's most important is knowing that someone's in my corner. I want to say that with more First Nations Inuit and Métis people achieving their education and taking their rightful place in Canada, we will all be enriched. So I invite every Canadian to join us in this initiative. Let me say again, Nyawagoa, for this award that I share with the Inspire team. Within a generation, every Indigenous student will graduate. Nyawagoa, thank you.
Congratulations to Roberta, oh my goodness, and to all of this year's finalists. The work you are doing to support our country's most vulnerable young people is truly inspiring. And now on to the next exciting part of tonight's program. At the Foundation, we know the importance of supporting youth who are transitioning out of child welfare in a holistic way. We hear from young people that having access to supports, resources, and programming that help them to build their own paths and create successful, independent lives after care is so crucial. It's so important. And having people in their corner as they make this transition and they plan for their futures is key. In today's world, a key piece of future building is, of course, education. Now, every year we come together to celebrate the incredible academic achievements of young people who, despite the barriers they've faced in the past, and those they may continue to face today, because we know there are many, have found the strength and determination to work hard on the path to achieving their goals and their dreams. Some young people have been faced with challenges such as disruptions to their education, and even graduating later than their peers because of frequently switching schools due to changing foster care placements or unstable home environments. But they're here, already successful in graduating high school, something that only half of youth involved in child welfare will achieve. They are achieving things that are difficult for anyone, let alone those who've experienced the challenges and barriers that they have faced. They are giving themselves the opportunity to access better jobs in the future. They're working to break the cycle of abuse, neglect, and poverty faced by many families involved in child welfare. They are simply doing amazing, beating all the odds. For all the students and graduates who are with us online tonight, we are so incredibly proud of all of you. This is why Children's Aid Foundation of Canada places such importance on supporting young people through their education to help them build their own futures of success. We are so grateful for the support of the generous donors. None of this would happen without you, many of whom are tuning in tonight. Thank you. Because of your generosity, last year the foundation was able to grant nearly $1.6 million, and that was in a variety of educational supports to young people across the country through the post-secondary education program. This year, thanks to our donors, we are thrilled to report that 268 scholarships, over 100 bursaries, and over 70 graduation awards have been granted to students completing their degrees, diplomas, and certificates in programs ranging from honors mathematics to interior decorating to digital design, social work, engineering, and more. How impressive is this group of young people? You can find the full slate of scholarship recipients as well as a donor listing on the foundation website at cfdn.org/events/standupforkidsnight. I invite you all to give these students a huge round of applause at home or share a note of encouragement right here in the chat. Congratulations, students. We're so proud of you. Now, I would like to take a moment to thank the Foundation Scholarships Awards Committee. Oh my goodness, do they do a lot of work, chaired by Lynn Factor. This group of volunteers comes together each year to review applications for educational supports from youth across Canada based on financial need, individual attributes, and academic achievement. Thank you for the time you put into helping young people from care access the financial supports they need to achieve their post-secondary education. For many, finding employment after completing their post-secondary education can be the next huge hurdle. Children's Aid Foundation of Canada's Youth Works program supports those graduating, as well as those who have chosen alternative paths for their futures, finding meaningful employment so they can live safe, secure, stable lives. Launched in 2017 with support from founding partner RBC, YouthWorks is a pre-employment program that aims to help youth in and from care to gain the skills they need to find and keep a job crucial and build a career that is meaningful to them through individual employment counseling and group workshops, hands-on skills training, and referrals to external certification, access to job placement and internships, and access to career development and networking opportunities. We're so excited to share that earlier this year, RBC confirmed an extension and expansion of their investment. And with the support of the foundation's first ever grant from the federal government, the program will be able to continue running in high priority areas in Ontario, British Columbia, Manitoba, New Brunswick, and Alberta over the next 3 years. To date, YouthWorks has seen a total of 922 youth access the program for support. I love to hear that. It's now my pleasure to introduce a new segment to this event. Earlier this week, I had the pleasure of having two youth ambassadors join me in a conversation about their experiences, both in care and along their life's journey to where they are today. Hello, I'm here with Marco and Yasmin. Marco's in his final year of his undergraduate degree at the University of Toronto, completing an honors Bachelor of Arts program with a double major in environmental and Indigenous studies and a minor in human geography. Yasmin is in her fourth year of her Bachelor of Social Work at York University. Everyone has been going through a lot with what has been happening. And so before I do any interview, I have to start with this. How are you? And are you okay? Yasmin, let me start with you. How have things been, amidst COVID and a racial pandemic, everything that's happening? How are you?
It's been quite stressful, from the health aspect, the pandemic, and then you have the whole Black Lives Matter movement and seeing Black people get killed by police on social media every single day. So it's been quite a stressful time.
It's trauma, and I think that when you step back and really look at it and unpack it, we're going through a lot. So it's good that you recognize that and acknowledge that. Marco, how about you? How have you been?
I've been okay. It is quite a lot to deal with the pandemic lately, but I've been super lucky to be at home with family and spending time together and being able to digest all of this together. So that's been really important for me.
I hear that. It's important to have those connections. They're the ones that are going to get you through, right? Now, every year, hundreds of youth transition out of care, and this is it's a tricky situation to make that transition. And we want to talk a little bit about that. For the two of you, what was the most challenging part of making that transition? And Marco, I'll start with you.
Yeah, my transition out of care was an adoption at the age of 10. And what made this transition really difficult for me was that I'd experienced a prior unsuccessful adoption. So this resulted in severe emotional and mental challenges for me. And I just wasn't able to trust adults in my life to keep to their word or act in my best interest.
So you're in this situation now where you find a family and things are working, but you have trust issues and, rightfully so. How do you find that you work through that? Or how did they help you work through that?
How does my current adoptive family help me work through the trust issues? Mm-hmm. It took a lot of time. It did take a lot of time, and it took constant actions. I think that phrase where actions speak louder than words was ever so true. And it was funny because my youngest brother was adopted first, and he would say things like, oh no, this mom, she keeps her promises. And that was something that was very profound for me. And it did take time for both my parents to prove that to me.
Actions, actions, actions. I hear that. Yasmin, how about you? What was the most challenging part of making that transition out of care?
So my transition out of care was actually into complete independence. So my transition, it was challenging just because finding affordable and stable housing, in Toronto with the market being so unaffordable, it was really challenging.
Did you have any support to do that? What did you do? For anyone watching this conversation and thinking, oh my goodness, I'm going to be heading towards that point where I have to be completely independent. Can you give us some idea of what you had to do to get that support and that help?
Yeah, and so I really tried to collaborate with my social worker at the time. And so we were just preparing for the transition out of care, looking at places together, and just sort of figuring out like what life after care is going to look like. So I just made a plan with my social worker and we tried to stick to it as best as we could.
If you don't have a place to live, I mean, that probably has to be the first concern. How can you do anything else if you don't have a roof over your head? Am I right?
Right. And so like youth that transition out of care are going through so much already. And so imagine trying to find a job or trying to get your education, but you don't have somewhere safe. You know, it's impossible.
What was it, do you think, that you you leaned on your social worker, but just internally, you have to have somewhat of a strong mindset in order to push yourself through obstacles like that. Was there anything you said to yourself that helped you get you through? Or was there anything you read that helped get you through? What was it that kept you going?
It was kind of just reminding myself, like, why I'm going to school, why I'm trying to be independent. I'm going to school to be a clinical social worker. So I kind of just kept reminding myself, like, I want to help youth that have been through similar things like me or have been through in the same predicament as me. So just reminding myself.
Yasmin, when did you discover that you want to actually go in the direction where you can help people like they have helped you? When did that click for you?
It was actually when I met my social worker, Nora. And so Nora is still my social worker now, but she is the best social worker I've ever met. She's like the most dedicated, the kindest and everything. And so I realized the way she helped me, I want to help other people that exact same way.
That's beautiful. Marco, do you have advice for youth who are in the same position of you that might be making this transition?
Yeah, my advice would be to not be afraid to ask for help. I know I've mentioned this issue of trusting adults in our life, but I think once you transition out of care, embodying the mindset that all these adults do want us to see us succeed is ever so evident. I think this event in and of itself is proof that there are people who want to see us succeed.
And you actually feel that and you believe that and you see proof of that, right?
Yeah, every day that I work with the Children's Aid Foundation is the things that we talk about, the projects that we're working on. It's kids are at the forefront of every conversation that we have. So I believe that wholeheartedly.
Listen, I've worked with a lot of different organizations, and the reason why I stick very close to Children's Aid Foundation is because the idea of standing up for kids is like all the way from the inside out. It's all the way through the organization, and I feel that. You know that as someone even coming in as a guest, their commitment is true. So I'm so happy to hear that you feel that as well. Yasmin, what advice, you probably have so much advice for someone that is going through the same thing that you've gone through, but what can you say to other youth that might be transitioning?
I would definitely say don't be afraid to cut off toxic people, because one thing about transitioning out of care, it's such a stressful situation. And it's like, if you have toxic people in your life, then it's going to be even more stressful. So just don't be afraid to cut off toxic people and find your peace.
Yasmin, did you, like, listen, as a 45-year-old, I've had a tough time cutting out toxic people. Like, this has been like a lifelong thing. So I'm wondering, how did you start to get some of that toxicity out of your life? How do you sort of separate yourself from that?
So first it starts from within, right? So if you identify toxic traits from within yourself, that's the first thing, like that's where you need to start, right? And so then you need to realize, are there friends in my life who are toxic? Is there family in my life who's toxic? Because even sometimes your family is toxic too, right? And so regardless, you just need to do what's best for you and let go of people that you feel like are like weighing you down or holding you back.
Really, really good point. Wise beyond your years, my friend. Mm-hmm. Now, all of this sort of speaks to the importance of having good people around you and having that really good network. And what I hear from people is that it's kind of tough to expand that friend and support circle unless you have actual action tips and ways to do that. So Marco, how did you sort of expand your network and make sure that you're surrounded by the people you need to be surrounded by.
Yeah, university played the biggest role in me networking and really finding myself. And for my experiences in university, it was actually Indigenous studies that really helped me network and find like-minded people and grow and heal from a lot of things that I went through in foster care. But I had to find the courage to look at clubs and organizations, and the Children's Aid Foundation was also another one where I was a little bit hesitant to join, but a couple of other members or other people who worked with the foundation really said, you can do it, come on in, and were really supportive, and it just took off from there.
Amazing. And so do you find that those people that you have made connections with, they're still an important part of your circle, of your networking group?
Yeah, I can always go to them with questions. Hey, I don't understand this, or where can I find a support resource for this, or my friend needs help, can I connect them with you? And they're always making themselves available and approachable for both myself and people around me.
It's almost like an interview process when you're meeting the sort of people that you want to keep in your life forever, right? Whether it's a romantic partner or a friend partner or a mentor, you're constantly sort of checking to see, are we aligned? Is this serving me, right? As what kind of relationship, what am I getting out of this relationship? What am I putting into it? But I think it's crucial, and it's a lesson for everyone. You got to surround yourself by people that are there to support you. Marco, you said something very interesting in the pre-interview, and I think it's a really important point. You said, don't underestimate your own resiliency. Tell me a little bit more about that.
Yeah, absolutely. I think times get tough. I mean, we were just talking about it this summer with COVID and racial injustices that we're facing in the world, and it can be a lot to take in, especially if you're transitioning out of care. And sometimes we buckle under the pressure. And I think what's helped me get through that is not underestimating how resilient we are. One thing I say to myself is, if I got through foster care, I can definitely get through this. And that's something that's kind of a mantra of my own.
Let's think about those tangible things that people might need, youth might need, as they are making the transition out of care. Yasmin, do you have some suggestions?
Yeah, so during my transition out of care, one thing I noticed was the lack of affordable housing. And so I think one thing that the foundation should begin to make a larger priority is transitional housing for youth that are transitioning out of care.
And what might that look like? Does that just mean housing that's more affordable? Does that mean a certain section of the market is held and specifically earmarked for youth coming out of transition?
Yeah, so what transitional housing for the foundation looks like typically is a home, and so it's semi-independent. So you live with other youth that have transitioned out of care, and then there are also social workers that come sometimes to assist you on like adulting, so how to cook, financial literacy, things like that. So they assist you with all those things for the year that you live there, and hopefully it helps you transition smoother to be fully independent.
And you're saying that we need more of that.
And more, yeah. There's only two of those homes that I know of currently, and each of those homes only house about like four or five youth. And imagine how many youth every year transition, right?
Mm-hmm. Very good suggestion, Marco. Anything specific that you want to put out there in terms of what might help youth making this transition out of care?
Yeah, I mean, I'm the biggest advocate for youth getting an education. It's probably the most empowering thing you can do for yourself. And not just for yourself, for people around you, for the people that you care about around you. You learn so much more about the world that you're living in and that you're transitioning into, and about yourself. You get a new perspective on what you went through. So I think it's the most empowering thing you can do for yourself.
I love it. And I want to ask both of you this: how do you stand up for kids? I can sort of piece together how you're doing that in your worlds, but Yasmin, I'm going to ask you the question first. How do you stand up for kids?
I stand up for kids by listening to them, advocating for them, being someone they can come vent to, like lean on, be that like crying shoulder. Because usually I work with youth or I work with smaller children. And so to be able to build those connections with them when they might not feel like they have anybody to build a connection with, like that's the best feeling to me.
Okay, Marco, what are you doing to stand up for kids?
I make kids the center of discussion all the time with anyone who will listen to me, really, and work with organizations that also put children at the forefront of what they do. And also in an educational sense, I'm planning to pursue a master's degree to study the social and emotional barriers youth and care face when pursuing post-secondary studies, so that way we can have more of us succeed.
I can tell you every year when I have the absolute honor of meeting more of the youth that have come through the Children's Aid Foundation or use the resources from the Children's Aid Foundation, it makes me so hopeful. And I feel like that's really important with the world being what it is. Seeing your stories, hearing how you have overcome again and again and again is the fuel that is going to inspire so many people that are watching this. So Yasmin and Marco, thank you. Thank you for sharing your journey and for continuing to move forward. You're both inspirations.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
So inspiring speaking to our ambassadors. Thank you. Now I'd like to introduce Valerie McMurtry, President and CEO of Children's Aid Foundation of Canada, and Daniel Barclay, Board Chair.
Good evening. I'm Dan Barclay, and I'm delighted to be here tonight in my new role as chair of the Children's Aid Foundation of Canada. It's an honor to be here among such an inspiring crowd of students, donors, and the 2020 winner and finalist for the Lynn Factor Stand Up for Kids National Award. This cause is both personally and professionally meaningful to me as a business leader, father, and a member of this community. I'm passionate about enabling a more diverse, inclusive, and equitable future for all Canadians, especially our most vulnerable. I'm honored to share with you that the 2019-2020 fiscal year was a very strong one for the Foundation. At the year ending March 31st, 2020, we raised total revenues of $12.4 million and have you, our loyal donors, to thank for this excellent achievement. We reached more than 19,340 children and youth and 4,295 families in partnership with 74 child and youth serving organizations across 10 provinces and one territory. Our new strategic plan, which we titled Strength to Change Lives, was finished early this year and was a culmination of many months of consultation and planning with the board of directors, donors, agency partners, government, and young people, and leverages evidence and promising practices observed within the child welfare sector. Our plan focuses on removing barriers and sharing access to opportunities for three priority populations: vulnerable families and children in the community who are at risk of coming into government care due to complex issues and circumstances like poverty and mental health; kids being raised in government care; and youth who are transitioning out of government care at the age of 18 to face a life on their own. The Foundation is particularly mindful that the challenges that many families, children, and youth are endured disproportionately by those in the Black and Indigenous communities. We recognize our responsibility to do more to listen and learn from these communities about the systemic discriminatory issues they face, and to respond with more unique and culturally appropriate programs. Over the next 5 years, we'll work alongside community-based groups looking to improve outcomes for these groups and specifically to address overrepresentation of Black and Indigenous children in child welfare. As we look ahead, we know we can't rest on our past successes, as there is more work to be done and impact we know it can make in support of Canada's most vulnerable populations. On behalf of our board of directors, I'd like to share that we are highly motivated to achieve more together and continue our work in the years ahead. I'm so proud to contribute to this organization and to work alongside a great team of staff and volunteers who are doing extraordinary work to improve the lives of children, youth, and families across the country. Now, I'll pass it over to Valerie, President and CEO of the Foundation, to provide some updates to you on this past year and some insights into the new fundraising campaign.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Valerie McMurtry, President and CEO of the Foundation. We're so happy that you've committed your time with us this evening to dial in virtually. We didn't want to let a world pandemic stop us from getting together to celebrate our collective impact over these past 12 months. Tonight, we are recognizing amazing young people who've overcome difficult odds to achieve extraordinary academic outcomes. And we're honoring passionate change makers from across the country who've committed themselves to improving the trajectory of the lives of countless children and youth. We're humbled by all of your efforts and are motivated as a foundation to continue to stand up for the things that we believe in and maintain our focus on significantly improving outcomes for children, youth, and families involved in child welfare. To say that 2020 so far has presented incredible change and challenge would be an understatement. We are devastated by the impact of COVID-19 on the children, youth, and families we serve, as well as on our own families and communities. Back in March, we pivoted swiftly to create the Foundation's COVID-19 response program. We established two funds, one dedicated to providing direct financial aid to former youth in care, and the second for agencies to use to support families and children they're working with deal with the sudden and devastating impacts of this pandemic. Already amongst the most vulnerable populations in the country, the pandemic is exacerbating financial instabilities, increasing housing and food insecurity, incidents of domestic violence, and social isolation. Through the incredible generosity and kindness of our loyal donor community, to date, we've been able to raise just over $9 million in a very short period of time. We are particularly humbled by the leadership of the Rogers family and their family foundation, who responded to our COVID-19 program with an incredibly generous $5 million cash gift, enabling us to outreach to community partners across the country. We're also grateful to have the support of the Government of Ontario, who committed early on $1.5 million as part of a matching community campaign in support of the COVID-19 Support Fund for former youth in care. This fund will directly impact the lives of former youth in care as they deal with sudden unemployment, housing instability, and the re-traumatizing effects of forced social isolation. Dan mentioned earlier that we have committed to a new 5-year strategic plan, and it outlines key priorities that will guide us over the coming years. While the plan has helped us to focus, our goal remains the same: to ensure that every young person involved with the child welfare system in every part of Canada has every opportunity to thrive. Within the plan, there are bold social impacts we want to achieve as part of this. Goals that will significantly improve outcomes, challenge old ways of thinking and doing, and build bold new partnerships. But none of that is possible without the Foundation committing to raise tons of money. I'm pleased to share tonight that we're kicking off a new fundraising campaign called the Stand Up for Kids Futures Transformed campaign. This is a $75 million effort that will help not only support the financial sustainability of our foundation, but create opportunities to build on existing programs that we know are delivering impact across the country and to innovate in new areas to realize tangible change. So we're so excited for what's next and ready to get started. To the donors and agency partners, volunteers and committee members joining in this evening, we want to say thank you for your support and your ongoing commitment to standing up for the children, youth and families we serve. And to the young people who are here with us tonight, our pledge to you is that we will always be in your corner, celebrating you and standing beside you. Now back to Tracy to help kick off our celebration for the class of 2020.
Tonight, I am excited to introduce you to Natasha, our 2020 Stand Up for Kids Night valedictorian. With the support of Children's Aid Foundation of Canada scholarships, Natasha is graduating from York University with two honors degrees in English and linguistics. She is passionate about teaching English, learning languages, and speech language pathology, and will be moving to Quebec to teach English as a second language. My goodness, please join me in welcoming Natasha for tonight's valedictorian address.
Hello, everybody. My name is Natasha. I'm a former York University student, a linguistics and literature nerd, a communication volunteer with March of Dimes, and a soon-to-be language monitor at Jumina Notre Dame, a private high school just south of Quebec City. I am also an online English language teacher for Zebra English, a Chinese company with lots of wonderful young ESL students. I am very proud to give this year's valedictorian address. When I was 14 years old, I was put into foster care. Due to mental illness in my family, I endured a lot of physical and psychological abuse throughout my childhood. When I got into my teenage years, I started acting out really badly. Eventually, after skipping school many times and having the police involved with my family many, many times, I was taken into foster care. When I entered foster care, it was truly heartbreaking for me. It's honestly the hardest thing for a child to go through, to be taken away from your own family. However, for the first time, I was not being screamed at or beaten anymore. I was finally able to think clearly, and it became very clear, very fast, that education was the only thing I could do to improve my future. I knew that I needed to get into university, so I began studying as hard as I could. It was definitely no easy feat. Just being able to feel normal for 1 minute, not depressed or anxious, was something that took years for me to achieve. After attending 4 different high schools, living in 2 foster homes, and finishing the last 2 years of high school while living solo in my own apartment, I finally managed to get into York University. When I got in, I was so lucky to be able to access lots of funding opportunities from the Children's Aid Foundation of Canada. Not only did I receive scholarships for each of my 4 years of study, but I also received funding for extra courses that I needed to advance my career, like my English Second Language Teacher Certificate. From the beginning of my studies to the end, I was highly motivated and encouraged by the Foundation's support to continue pursuing my dreams, no matter how ambitious they may have seemed at the time. Because of the amazing support, I was able to pursue 2 undergraduate degrees, one in linguistics and one in English. Now, I am in a great position to teach English all around the world, and that is what I intend on doing for the next couple of years. I already got my first post-graduation job in Quebec City, and I am planning on teaching English in France while living with my longtime partner, who is French. By the way, I met him on a volunteering trip in Brazil, which is another educational project which I received funding for from the Foundation. I cannot stress enough how much of a positive impact the Foundation has made in my life. This kind of funding is so important for former foster kids because it allows us to feel like we really do have a chance to turn our lives around for the better, even if our whole lives we have been told otherwise. After teaching English for a few years, I hope to get into a master's program in speech-language pathology. This is kind of like the medical side of linguistics, and I would really love to be able to use my skills to help people who are having trouble communicating. I just spent the last year volunteering with stroke and brain injury survivors, and it was truly life-changing to learn their stories and to help them reach their recovery goals. I would just like to let my peers know that prospects really do change once you get that degree in your hand. I know that it's really hard to stay up until 4 o'clock in the morning, pounding out your essays, when all you want to do is watch Netflix and sleep till noon. But believe me, the pain is worth it. Nothing makes me happier than seeing my peers succeed in their studies and in their careers. With the support of the Foundation, we can all definitely make it happen. And finally, I would like to say thank you to all of the donors, sponsors, and allies for supporting young people in and from care. You have made such an incredible difference in so many people's lives already, and we will never forget how kind you were to us with your support. I myself would like to personally thank the Barrett family, who gifted me the Barrett Family Scholarship 3 times from 2015 to 2017, and the Steinhauer family for the 2019 Dr. Paul D. Steinhauer Memorial Scholarship. You have all changed our lives for the better, and we will do our best to continue making you proud. I hope everyone enjoys the rest of their night, and I hope I can meet you all in person soon. Bye.
Thank you, Natasha. We are also excited to see where your degrees take you. Congratulations on everything you've achieved so far. Now, I have a question for everyone. What do you get when you mix strength, hard work, determination, brains, and the support of generous foundation donors? You get graduates. It's my pleasure to introduce you to the group of young people who have completed their academic programs this year and are recipients of graduation awards and the Elon Levy Graduation Award of Excellence, recognizing academic achievement and determination. Congratulations to each and every one of you. We are so inspired by your accomplishments and so proud of you. Accompanying the virtual parade of graduates, we are excited to have an artist from Slate Music.
We crossed the highway, line by line, and we're wasting the sunset's precious time. We make this bridge our evening shrine. We're missing all the rules, sign by sign.
Turn back.
once again, congratulations to our graduates. We know you're all in your homes, but give them a round of applause at home. Send some warm wishes in the chat. They need all of our support. They have beaten the odds and done incredible. A huge thank you for inviting me back again tonight, even though I only had to go upstairs to my guest room. Congratulations once again to all of this year's scholarship recipients and graduates. Once again, we're so proud of you. Do you get that yet? I've said it a few times, so proud of you. Everyone on the screen and behind the scenes, we are rooting for you. We are already incredibly proud of your accomplishments and wish you all the best as you continue on dreaming, planning, and thriving and achieving. Congratulations to Roberta Jameson and all of the five finalists of the Lynn Factor Stand Up for Kids National Award. We wish you all the best as you continue your work to improve the lives of children and youth in and from child welfare. To the many donors, supporters, and child welfare agency partners joining us this evening, thank you for continuing to offer such crucial support and hope for the young people here tonight and those who, of course, could not be with us. A recording of tonight's virtual event will be available on the Foundation's website in the coming weeks. You can watch it again and again and again. Thank you again to our Stand Up for Kids partners, CIBC, Stand Up for Kids lead community partner, for your generous support of tonight's event and the Stand Up for Kids movement. The Globe and Mail, our Stand Up for Kids national print media partner. AMJ Campbell, our Stand Up for Kids national move partner. And the Slate Family Foundation for providing the music for this year's graduate parade. Have a good night and thanks for having me back.